Before I start to preach tonight, I just want you to look at your neighbor and say, hey, neighbor, I've been saving up this praise all day long. Go ahead and praise him like you've got something saved up. Hallelujah. Well, I want you to get your Bibles and look to Matthew 7, 7 and 8. If you don't have your Bibles, you follow along on the screen, or you can get out your electronic device and you can follow along there. But I'm starting a new series called Hidden Figures. And I was really moved Sunday as Pastor Dawn talked about prayer. And how much of a change that my life has experienced by people who've prayed for me that I didn't know anything about. Hidden Figures who were faithful. And there was a movie that came out recently with that same title, Hidden Figures. And I don't know if you saw it. I would recommend it. It's one of the greatest movies that I've seen in a long time. And it's the incredible, largely untold story of Katherine Johnson, Dorothy Vaughan, and Mary Jackson. And these were brilliant African-American women who were working at NASA, who served as the brains behind one of the greatest operations in history when John Glenn was launched into orbit, if you remember that incredible time. And this was before computers came around. And it was such a stunning achievement. And it was during the Cold War, and it restored the nation's confidence, and it turned around the space race. And this visionary trio, they were used greatly by God, but they were hidden figures. Nobody knew about them. They were unsung heroes until just recently. And I'll tell you, we owe so much to hidden figures in the body of Christ. We think often that it's those who are on the stage or in front of the camera, but in reality, it's hidden figures that have made the church what it is today. It's been praying mamas. It's been selfless missionaries. It's been people who loved Jesus when it wasn't easy. And I'm telling you, God is still looking for hidden figures. God's still looking for people who don't need a title. Come on now. God's still looking for people who don't need to be exalted, but who just come to bless his name. I believe I'm going to teach and help you tonight. If you're ready, say, I'm ready. Amen. Matthew 7, 7 and 8 says, ask and it will be given to you. Man, isn't that good news? Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. Man, do you know a God like that? Hallelujah. He said, for everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be open. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about unsung heroes. If you want to get in the same anointing I'm going to teach and preach in, let's just slip up our hands and ask Jesus to have his way. Lord, I believe I've prepared tonight, and I'm ready for tonight and Sunday and for the next few services to talk about hidden figures and how you're looking for people that you want to use in a mighty way. Thank you for your presence in this room. Send us now all that we need as we teach and preach your word in Jesus' name. Somebody give the Lord a clap and a shout. Amen. Be seated. Man, I owe so much to people that you will never know and you've never met who prayed for me, who supported me, who stood behind me. And really, the kingdom rests on the power of hidden figures. And I love this text tonight because it said, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. I wonder if there's anybody in this next season, you're asking God for some things. Are there some things you need the Lord to do? How many of you are seeking God for some things? How many of you are knocking on the door and believing God to bring some breakthroughs? Isn't it good to know that he has done it before? And he will do it again, because he's the same, the Bible said, yesterday, today, and forever. Praise God. Now listen, unsung heroes are what I'm going to talk about for a few minutes. And, you know, there are really unsung heroes that work every week in this ministry, that literally hold this church together. You know, all that goes on here, it's people that serve behind the scenes that make it happen. I wouldn't be able to do what I do unless there were unsung heroes who served faithfully, got here early, made sure they were greeting people. We have guys that drive and pick folk up and drop them off at the door. And I'm just thankful for so many unsung heroes, people that pray and seek the face of God and who are faithful. They're hidden figures who serve and they give and they pray and they have no stage and no applause and few accolades this side of heaven. But I want to tell every unsung hero here at Calvary how much I appreciate you, how much you mean to me. Why don't we just give everyone who serves at Calvary, give them a God bless you. We appreciate you so much. And I want to tell you that in Jesus' name, this is the year of supernatural expansion. I'm putting every drop of my faith around that reality, that he who began a good work in us is going to be faithful to complete it, that he hasn't brought us this far to leave us. He didn't teach us to swim to let us drown. Come on, somebody. And I'm believing that this year we're not going to settle. We're asking, we're seeking, we're knocking. We're believing, God, that this is the year that we see all that the Lord has for us. And here's my admonition to you, even at the beginning of this message. It's time to put the hammer down. Come on. It's time to put the accelerator on the floor and go after God with all you have. It's time to intensify the RPMs. Come on. RPMs stand for revolutions per minute. And if you were at the racetrack Sunday, you know there were some big time RPMs around that track. And I want to speak to everyone in this room, every unsung hero who's hungry for more of God. Every one of you in this room who want to see God move in a mighty way in your family, in your business, in your finances, in your personal life. I'm going to talk to men and women in the house, and I'm going to talk to you about RPMs because it's time to rev it up. Tell your neighbor, zoom, zoom, hallelujah. It's time to rev it up. Number one, I'm looking for RPMs, unsung heroes. I'm looking, number one, for RPMs, real praying men. I'm looking for some men that know how to get a hold of God. I love it when women pray, but make no mistake about it, there's something that happens when a man knows how to pray. When a man knows how to get a hold of God, and I'm looking throughout the rest of this year for some real praying men. The Bible said in Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Now, my brothers, let me talk to you a minute. Make no mistake about it. In many ways, many of us have been in a stretch the last few years, even a strain. Make no mistake about it. In today's world, it takes a man to be a man. Can I get a witness? It takes a man to be a man. And if we've ever needed real praying men, we need real praying men today. Unsung heroes who will pray for their families, who will pray for revival, who will seek the face of God for miracles. And let me tell you something, ladies, if you're looking to date a man, find you a good man. Find you a praying man. Find you a man that's got a touch of God on his life, and you'll be glad that you did, I'll tell you that. But we appreciate good men. Are you thankful for the good men that are in the room tonight? Come on, let's give all the good men a God bless you. Much of the church I see around the world as I travel, much of the church is in crisis, and a lot of the crisis is a crisis of manhood. But when men rise up, when men rise up to lead their homes, when men rise up to be spiritual, that's when things begin to change. Because here's what I know. When a man is in crisis, the whole family's in crisis. When a man's in trouble, the whole family's in trouble. And many of the kingdom, they're looking for answers, and we're looking too much for natural answers. Even in church realms, we think if we can create better methods and have better strategies, that things will finally be what they need to be in the body of Christ and in the church. But all these are fine, but we got to keep our focus right. See, the church is looking for better methods, but God is looking for better men. The church is looking for better strategies, but God is looking for a few good men. Hallelujah. The church is looking for better methods and new programs and more profound plans. But let me say something. God does not anoint or come on methods. God does not anoint or come on programs or even plans. The Holy Spirit does not flow through methods, but men. He does not come on programs, nor does he anoint plans. God anoints men. God will give you a great plan, but God anoints a man. God will greatly use real praying men. And let me tell you something, sir, you can get a strategy, you can have a plan for the next season in your life, but what you need is for the Spirit of God to come on you and anoint you. When you pray, that's when things are going to shift. For too long, we pushed prayer towards the women. We pushed intercession towards the women. But in the early days, it was the men that sought the face of God. It was the men that prevailed and went after God in the early church. I'm going to talk to you women. Just let me get the men. Let me talk to them for a minute. We need some men that will pray, because prayer will give you clarity. Prayer will provide reverence. Prayer will give you resolve. Prayer will bring about the results. Everything you've been trying to break your neck to figure out, sir, if you will get in the presence of the Lord, prayer will reveal what you're looking to see. There are different types of prayer. There are different categories, as it were, in men. I want to see you do them all. If you're going to be an unsung hero, one of the things you're going to have to do is learn how to pray. Now, the first type of prayer I want to talk to you about is petition, brothers. It involves asking God to meet our personal needs and wants and desires. It's us saying, God, this is what I need. It's called the prayer of petition. And here's the good news. God is not insulted when you ask him for stuff. I got 12 people that are thankful for that. I said, God is not insulted when you say, Lord, I need your help. I have petitions that I need you to help me with. See, the Bible says you do not have because you do not ask in James 4:2. I don't want to miss out on God's provision in my life because I didn't have the audacity to ask him for what I needed. Now, my children can ask me for stuff and they know there's a good chance they'll get it because I'm a good father. But let me tell you about a good father. Come on. If I know how to give good gifts to my children, how much more does he know how to provide for us? The Bible said you do not have because. Somebody say because. Because you do not ask. The word because there means on account of or for this reason. And I'm telling you, I want to see some men start asking. I want you to ask for what you need, brothers. I want you to get bold and ask for your children to be saved. Ask for your marriage to be restored. Ask for your money to get right. Ask for that job you're believing for. Ask for a new anointing. Ask God for the breakthrough. Ask God for the open door. Ask God for the new anointing. Ask God for family salvation. I'm telling you, this year I'm asking. Thank God for 5 people that are with me. I said, this year I'm asking. Come on, I said, this year I'm asking. I said, this year I'm asking. The Bible said ask. It said seek. And it said knock. See, the truth is, in the text that we just read in Matthew 7, the Bible said ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find, and knock and it shall be opened unto you. And I want to go real deep in this, but that text, if you look at it in the original, it's in its linear form. In other words, it means to ask and keep on asking. It means to seek and keep on seeking. It means to find. It means to search until you find. I don't know if you have any kids. Like, I have some kids. One of my kids in particular is named Channing Hope Raley. She's the little one that dances all over the stage with the curly hair and loves to worship God. This child is relentless. If she asks you for something, she don't ask one time. Do any of you have any children like that? That will ask and ask and ask and ask and ask and ask, and you either have to give it to them or spank them. Can I get a witness in the house? And for too long, we have been people that ask and give up. We've been people that do not pursue God. But part of the reason that I respond to my children is because I enjoy their pursuit. Oh. I enjoy them coming up to me and saying, Daddy, I need you. Daddy, I want you. Daddy, I got to have you do this. And I'm telling you, men, this is the season when you petition God. This is the time when you ask God. If you're going to ask God, men and women, for big things in the next season, give him a shout in the house. Hallelujah. So keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Now, knock like a Jehovah's Witness. Come on. Did them Jehovah's Witnesses come to your house? Man, they came to my house a while back beating on the door. And you know you're tired out. They come early in the morning. The devil is a liar. And they're beating on the door. And I came to, I got them. I went to the door, morning breath and all. Come on. And I opened the door and they said, we're Jehovah Witnesses. I said, no way. They said, yes. I said, you're Jehovah Witnesses. They said, yes. I said, me too. I said, I've been witnessing for Jehovah for 33 years. They said, what kingdom hall are you at? I said, Calvary Christian Center up there on Granada. I'm the pastor there. You should have seen them jokers get out of my house and get out of my yard. They didn't want to have a conversation with me. I don't know why I told you that, but hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, keep knocking. The next is the prayer of intercession. Petition means I'm asking God for things, but then, men, I want to see you become an intercessor. Intercession is powerful because intercession is this. It means to entreat God for favor, to stand in and represent someone. It means to stand in the gap. I believe intercession is a beautiful type of prayer because intercession is this. It's the prayer that Jesus prays. He sits at the right hand of the Father making intercession for you and for me. So when you intercede, you act as a go-between. When you intercede, you take yourself and you put yourself in position to pray and believe for others. And see, I'm looking for some gap men. I'm looking for some men who will stand in the gap in the next season. Praying men, arise, honey, look out. Men that will stand in the gap for their children. Men that will stand in the gap for revival. Men that will stand in the gap for a breakthrough. Where are the men that will stand in the gap? Where are the men that will pray? Where were the men that will say, devil, you can't have my son. You can't have my daughter. You can't have my purpose. You can't have my destiny. Be a gap man. Hallelujah. Be a gap man. Be a man who stands in the gap. There's the prayer of petition and prayer of intercession. I had more time, I would teach these, and I may in more detail in the coming weeks. But then there's the prayer of supplication. And that is found in James 5:16. It says, the fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. Now, what is prayer? Write this down. Prayer is the accurate definition. The accurate definition for prayer is supplication. And so when you pray, most often the word prayer is translated supplication. And the Bible said it avails. Avails means it renders much. It accomplishes much. And supplication means this. When you pray prayers of supplication, you're praying prayers of urgency. A prayer of supplication is a prayer that says, I can't fix it, God, I need you to fix it. I can't change it, God, I need you to change it. I can't heal it, God. I need you to heal it. See, men, this means that we pray with a sense of urgency, deep concern, prayer that's accompanied by a burden. So many men have lost their sense of urgency, and there needs to be a sense of urgency in the body of Christ, and we need to pray with a sense of urgency. I'm looking for some RPM, some real praying men who will pray with a sense of urgency. Then the fourth type of prayer is the prayer of travail. So we've talked about intercession. We've talked about petition. We've talked about supplication. But now let me tell you about travail. Travail is energy put into prayer. Travail means that I'm going to give all I've got and I'm going to birth this thing. I'm going to see it come to pass. Students who graduate and become doctors or lawyers or get a degree, they do it because they travail. They travail in their studies. Athletes travail. People that work out travail. travail. Women who give birth, they travail. And I'm going to tell you that we're in desperate need of men that know how to travail. Men that know how to say, devil, I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it feels like. I'm going to travail and I'm going to put energy in this thing and I'm going to see my family broke through. I'm going to see my purpose come to pass. Listen, travail speaks of birthing, and I know you don't like to think about that, men, but you need to get spiritually pregnant in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And there's a pain and a price for birthing. You got to take that thing in your heart. There are some things that I have took on my heart that I will not be denied over. I am not going to be denied what God has promised me this year. The Lord said that this is a year of expansion, and in Jesus' name, we are going to have a year of expansion. I'm going to see breakthrough. I'm going to see everything that I'm praying for. I'm not going to quit. And somewhere in your life, you have to get a tenacity that gets down inside of you and said, God, I'm going to birth this thing, and I'm going to see it come to pass. Real praying men. Prayer doesn't make you weird. Prayer makes you dangerous. Huh? Tell your neighbor, he's a bad man. Come on. He's a bad man. Listen, if somebody comes after you, you don't need the Terminator. You just need to get a man that knows how to get a hold of God and seek the face of God. We need some real praying men. Come on, somebody. Some breakthroughs you're trusting God for will only be manifested through the power and price of travail and the pain of travail. Mark 11:24, there's a story when Jesus came off the cross, and the Bible said, actually, the Bible talks about when Jesus came off the cross, it said that the man craved, Joseph of Arimathea craved his body. He desired the Lord. And we see that same word in Mark 11. It says, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. And the word ask there means to desire. It means to beg. It means to call for. It means to crave. I'm craving some things this year. I don't want business as usual. I don't want just another year to go by. I'm believing that God is going to do some things this year. I'm going to be a real praying man. And praise the Lord. Maybe you haven't seen it yet. Maybe you haven't seen the thing that you're believing God for. You haven't seen it come into fruition. But hear me, blessing delayed does not mean blessing denied. It's time to travail. Now, let me talk to the women. Okay, we got some RPM. Some real praying men. Everybody give the real praying men a hand because we want to see some real praying men. But then let's talk to the girls. RPM number two, we need some revived, prepared maidens. We need some women who are revived. Not who are barely surviving, not just barely getting by, but women who are revived and prepared. Watch this, Matthew 15:1-12. It says, the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Now, 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took the oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at the midnight cry, when it was heard, behold, the bridegroom is coming, go out to meet him. Then all these virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said, give us some of your oil, for the lamps are going out. But the wise answered and said, no, lest there shall not be enough for us and for you. But go gather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went out with him in the wedding, and the door was shut. Afterwards, the other virgins also came, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, assuredly, I say unto you, I do not know you. Now we need some wise women, not foolish women. Okay, I got a few amens there. I said we need some wise women, not foolish women. Women who are preparing for the bridegroom Jesus. They're preparing for a move of God. This is a powerful parable spoken from the very lips of the Lord. And it's the story of being prepared. The word prepare, if you divide the word up, it's actually pre and pare. That pare is the French version. It comes from the French. Pre means before, and pare means to make ready. So it means you're ready in advance. And I'm telling you, sisters, it's time to get ready. Hear me in this room. In this story, we read that the bridegroom came, but the foolish virgins missed it because they were not prepared. They had not made themselves ready. They were sleeping when they should have been preparing. But when women start getting ready for what God is about to do in their lives, look out. I'm trying to tell some women, get ready. In the next season, get ready. Jesus is about to show up in your situations and turn some things around. I said, women, get ready. Your children aren't saved yet, but the Lord says, get ready. Your money ain't right yet, but the Lord says, get ready. You haven't seen your breakthrough yet, but the Lord said, get ready. You haven't seen the turnaround yet, but the Lord said, get ready. Are there any women in the house getting ready for what God is going to do in the next season? See, it's women that are prepared and ready. You're going to be the unsung hero for your family. Tell your neighbor, I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. In this room tonight, there are men and women that are wise and foolish. But let me give you some lessons from this parable. See, here's the deal. These women had prepared before. But write this down. No one should trust in previous accomplishments. You can't get by on what you did yesterday. You can't get by on what you did last year. You can't make it on what happened 5 years ago. God said, if you'll get ready, I'll do exceedingly abundantly far above anything that you can ask or even think. Hallelujah. See, these unwise women had made some preparations, but foolishly trusted in what they had done in the past. And I would say to you, no way. We got to have fresh oil. Is there anybody who wants some fresh oil? I said, is there anybody who wants some fresh oil? I need a breakthrough in 2017. I'm looking for God to move for me, Pastor, in 2017. I'm looking for some turnarounds this year. Listen, you have been beat down and depressed and discouraged long enough. Jesus is about to come into your situation, but you got to get yourself ready. That means I'm shaking off the depression. I'm shaking off the doubt. I'm shaking off the fear. I'm shaking off the anxiety. Lord, I'm ready for you to show up and bring me what I need. Hallelujah. Somebody say fresh oil.
Fresh oil.
Come on, shout fresh oil.
Fresh oil.
These foolish virgins, they ran out of oil and they were not prepared. But unsung heroes keep some oil. Tell your neighbor, keep some oil. Oh, my, keep some oil. Long as you got some oil, everything is going to be all right. Do you remember the story of the woman with the sons and they were going to be sold into bondage and slavery because of the debt of the woman, and all the woman had was a little bit of oil? But when the anointing came on the oil was enough, and the oil is symbolic of the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and all the woman had left was some oil. And how many times has the devil come against you, and he thought he had you, but you still had some oil? My God, he would have done better to have left the woman and took the oil, left the man and took the oil, left the money and took the oil, left the house but took the oil. But he left you with some oil. And long as you got the oil, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you got everything you need to get back everything you lost. Oh, how many times in my life did I think it was over, but I had some oil? How many of you still got some oil in the room? Tell your neighbor, keep some oil. Yeah, I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it feels like. If you've got some oil, honey, Jesus will show up when you got some oil. My God, that wasn't in my notes, but boy, that felt good. I'll tell you that. Tell your neighbor, keep the oil. As long as you got some oil, sisters, you're going to be all right. Keep some oil. Unsung heroes, hidden figures. They know how to pray. Unsung heroes, hidden figures. They know how to keep connected to the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Now listen, you know that there were some dark times that you made it through because you had some oil. You were prepared. But let me just say this. Remember in this story, the foolish virgins went to the wise ones and said, "Give me some of your oil." But see, preparedness is non-transferable. You got to have your own oil. You can't get by on your mama's oil or your sister's oil or your daddy's oil. I got my own oil. Get your own oil. See, an engine can't run without oil. It's, oh, Jesus. Some of y'all need an oil change and a lube job. Can I get a witness in the house? When we have real praying men and we have revived, prepared maidens, you get ready in this next season. We're going to see what God's promised us to see. Now, that brings me to the third and final thing. How many of you want to see some real praying men? Make a little noise if you want to see some real praying men. Friday night, I'm going to be here. Yes, ma'am, I'm coming. My wife said I was. Hallelujah. But I was coming whether she said I was or not. But I just kind of let her feel like she's in charge sometimes. Because we have an agreement at my house. She makes her money and spends it like she wants to. And I make my money and spend it like she wants to. Come on, somebody. She does what she wants to. And I do what she wants me to. How many of you know that works? But listen, when you get real praying men, and then you get revived, prepared maidens, here's the third thing that's going to happen. RPM in 2017, we're going to have a radical praise movement. I don't know about you, but I want to be a part of a radical praise movement. I wish I had a praise team that was out here. I want my church to be the most radical, rowdy, loud, excited, joyful. I don't want you to go to Razzles to dance. I want you to come to work on Monday and your friends say, "What did you do?" You say, "I danced a weekend away." They said, "Did you go to Razzles? Did you go to the club on the beach?" I don't know what Razzles is. Pastor Troy told me about it. Come on, y'all. Did you go to the club? No, I went to Calvary Christian Center and I danced and I gave God glory. I want to see a radical praise movement in this church. Tell your neighbor, say, "Neighbor, you are a part of a radical praise movement." Yes. If you don't like to praise the Lord, it's going to be a long night for you, because we're about to praise God in this house. Let me tell you, have you ever been sitting by somebody radical in church and they carry on and they act crazy and they swing their weave in your face? And you say, "My God, she has swung her weave in my face this whole..." I know if you go to Calvary, you've experienced that before. And you say, "I won't sit here next Sunday." And then you move to another seat and she moves right with you. You come to another service and there she is. Maybe God is trying to tell you something. We are so quick to judge somebody's shout. We are so quick to judge somebody's clap. We are so quick to judge somebody's praise. But if God had done for you what he did for them, you might be shouting too, and you might be dancing too. For a radical praise movement. I think our church has been great. I think what we've seen is awesome, but it is time for praise and worship to go to another level in this house. It is time for the glory of God to come in this place. Tell your neighbor, it's time. Somebody give the Lord a crazy praise in here. Stand up, I gotta finish. Watch this. Radical is from the Latin word radix, and it's from the, it's literally from the word radish. Radical is from our word radish. And radish means to get down to the root. Do you know that a radish is a root? A radish means I'm getting back to the root. I'm getting back to the source. I think we've got too cute in church. I think we've got too worried about what people say about us in church. I think we've got too cute to praise God in church. We used to dance and we used to shout and we used to cry and we used to run all over the building and we used to get excited about the things of God. But now we've learned how to be a little bit dignified and we've learned how to just go through the motions. But there is a generation that's rising that says, get me back to the root. Get me back to the source. Let me get excited again about what's really important. Hallelujah. In a radical praise movement, we're calling people back to the source. Now, the Bible says in Psalm 67, hallelujah, if you knew that I have been sick all day long, I've been in bed a good part of the day, and I didn't even know if I was going to make it tonight, but I've got in this room and I feel something in the house. I feel my help coming on. Where are the praises at? The Bible said, let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you. Tell your neighbor, all the people. Hallelujah. Say all the people. Somebody raise your right hand. I now deputize you to be the praise leader on your pew. I tell you, you are the worship leader on your pew. Tell everybody on your row, get with it. Tell your neighbor, say, I don't know about the row in front of me. I can't tell you about the row behind me. But this row right here is about to break through. This row right here is about to see miracles. This row right here is about to move into God's presence. The Bible said, are y'all with me tonight? Hallelujah. The Bible said, let all the people praise you. Oh God, let the people praise you. Watch this now. Then the Lord shall yield her increase. God, our own God, shall bless us. He said, if I can find people that will praise me, the earth shall yield her increase. God, our own God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, and all the ends of the earth shall fear him. What would you do if you knew that increase was attached to your praise? That blessing was attached to your praise. That God said, if I can find people that will praise me, I will bless those people. What if it was the debt that you're wanting to get out of? What if it's the problem that you're having right now? What if your breakthrough is locked up in your praise? Let me tell you what I'm going to do. I've been believing the Lord that Calvary Christian Center and every ministry of this house is coming out of debt. So I'm dancing right now and saying, God, I don't know how you're gonna do it, but I'm gonna praise you like it's already done. I dare somebody right now, give God a praise for what you're believing him for. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, I'm praising God right now for increase in my life. Give him praise.
Come on, y'all ain't heard me talk about increase in a long time. I need somebody to give God praise for increase right now. To give God praise for increase right now. Lord, I call increase over your people. I call increase over this house. Now, listen. Ask your neighbor, say, hey neighbor, is there anything unreleased in your life that may be released during a throwdown praise? Good God Almighty. The word praise there in the Hebrew is the word yada. It means to give thanks to Lord, to praise, and to throw a praise down. Tell your neighbor, say neighbor, is there anything in your life that is unreleased that might be released during a throw down praise? John, is there anything in your life unreleased that might be released in a throw down praise? Oh my God, my God, my God. You don't need to praise God till you feel good. You don't need to praise God till you feel good. You need to praise God till you break through. You don't need to praise God till it feels good. You need to praise God till your body's healed, till your children are saved. You need to praise God till you break through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know what you're about to sing, but I need for the next couple minutes somebody that's going to be a part of a radical prayer. You're going to be a part of it. That wants to be a part of a radical praise movement. Hallelujah. I want you to get ready. Hallelujah. Ask your neighbor, say neighbor, do you remember how to praise him? Do you remember how to praise him? Do you remember how to praise him? Do you remember how to praise him?
See, I gotta praise, I gotta praise, and I gotta let it out.
I gotta shout and I gotta let it out. I gotta shout, I gotta dance, yeah.
I gotta dance, I gotta dance, and I gotta let it out.
My God, I can't get off of this. You've been worried long enough. You've been depressed long enough. You've been uptight long enough. You have had the enemy attack you long enough. God says that your miracle is attached to your willingness to go right ahead on and give him praise. I'm telling you, God is releasing something fresh. Hallelujah. Hey, I gotta shout.
I gotta shout and I gotta let it out.
Well, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body.
He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. Oh, I'm gonna praise His name. He stays just the same. Come on and praise Him. Look what the Lord has done.
Oh, I know we're going old school, but say, look what the Lord
has done.
Yeah, look what the Lord has done.
Just in time,
oh, I'm gonna praise His name.
He stayed just the same.
Come on and praise Him.
Look
what the Lord has done. Come on and praise Him.
Come on and praise Him.
Look what the Lord has done.
Come on and praise Him.
Come on and praise Him.
Look what the Lord has done.
Listen, here's my exhortation to you. Don't just praise God till you feel good. Praise God till you break through. And I'm still at this place, you know, I'm 53 years old. I am a little bit west of 50.
Amen.
But Pastor Don ain't all that far behind. But I never want to lose my willingness to praise the Lord. It's what got me to where I am today. And there are some things that are non-negotiable in my life. But here's what I know about a real praiser. A real praiser don't even need an audience. A real praiser don't even need a stage. Don't even need lights. A real praiser knows that everything I have, it's because of Him. So what I'm going to ask you to do in the next season, I'm going to ask you to come to this house like never before, ready to praise the Lord. That I want this church to be known for a radical praise movement. Hallelujah. I want us to entertain the presence of God. But here it is, precious. I need some revived, prepared maidens. The Lord would say to ladies, sisters, prepare yourself for what Jesus is going to do. The bridegroom came to those maidens that were prepared, and I speak in faith that He's going to come into your season, come into your life, come into your situation. And I need some men that will pray with me in this next season. Men that will reach out and touch God. Something happens when men pray. I'm coming Friday night, honey, and I'm going to pray. See, unsung heroes, man, they'll praise Pastor Troy without an audience. Unsung heroes, these women, they'll prepare in the dark when nobody's looking. Unsung heroes, men that know how to pray. This Sunday morning now, God's given me a fresh word called behind the scenes. The Lord said if you knew what He was doing behind the scenes, you'd really be encouraged. He's been talking to me, y'all. I love Him so much. Anybody love Him? I just love Him. I'd love Him like this if I wasn't a pastor. I just love Him. Can I pray over you tonight? Will you slip up your hands? Lord, thank You for real praying men that You're going to raise up in the next season at Calvary. Thank You for real praying men. Thank You for prepared, revived, prepared maidens, women who are ready for what You want to do. Come on, ladies.
in your life. I declare that you'll be prepared and getting yourself ready for what the Lord wants to do. And I declare that this room is full of unsung heroes who don't need an audience to praise you, Lord. I declare that in 2017, even though Calvary has been one of the most free churches in the nation, that in the next 10 months, that we're going to see a radical praise movement emerge out of this house with our young people and with our young adults and with everyone in this room. I thank you for it in Jesus' name. If you love him, give him a praise tonight. Come on, Pastor John, you sing us out. God bless you, folks.
Oh,